Thank you for joining us once again as we worship our Lord together here through the community of Vermont Lutheran Church in Black Earth, Wisconsin. We invite you to come back each week as we worship online during this time of pandemic. And if you'd like to know anything more about Vermont Lutheran Church, please visit us on our webpage at www.vermontlutheran.org. So let's begin our worship. Let's start with some announcements first. We want to say a couple of things, especially our sympathies going out to Janet Castle and to the family of Virginia Johnson. Jenny died this past Friday at St. Mary's Rehab Center in Verona, Wisconsin. Our sympathies are with her family, and ask for God's wonderful direction and acceptance as he brings her into a more peaceable kingdom. Also, we want to thank you and issue congratulations to Carol Johnson. Carol was our Vermont Lutheran Vice President of the Council, but Carol has accepted a new full-time job which will take up a lot of her time and attention, so she has stepped down from the Council. But in the meantime, she accepts this new position with the Make-A-Wish Foundation, and we want to thank her heartily for all of her time and effort that she has given to our congregation council, and wish her all the very best in her new position. Along those same lines, we want to thank Joel Fürchtinger and Paul Dibdahl for their agreement to be on church council. Joel has accepted a call to replace an empty position for the time being, and Paul Dibdahl has agreed to step in Carol's place as vice president of the council for the time being, and keep our council running in tip-top shape. So thanks to Joel and Paul for those things. Let us begin our worship for this week as we read responsively from the call to worship. Prepare a way for the Lord. Clear a pathway. The valleys and the mountains will be leveled. Everyone will see it. Prepare a way for the Lord. Clear a pathway. And then, knowing that we are all sinners and in need of forgiveness, we confess our sins before God and one another. God of light, you light a fire within us and ask us to shine, but we are quick to hide and make excuses. We shrink from challenges, avoid responsibility, and deny the goodness of your creation. We seek hollow praise and then don't believe it. Forgive us for hiding our God-given light and remaining self-absorbed. Children of God, never fear, for you have always lived in the mercy of your Creator. Hear the words of absolution and believe them. You are forgiven, you are made whole, and you are restored to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Let us hear from previous time in which the congregation of Vermont was able to meet, and we sang. Let us sing our opening hymn, hymn number 634. We're going to sing verses 1 through 4.
Thank you.
And let us pray together our prayer for this day. God of truth, through John, you challenged your people to repent. Move us also to put aside the things that get in the way of truly serving you, for the sake of Jesus our Savior. Amen. And our lesson for this week from the book of Luke, chapter 3, beginning in verse 1. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Etruria and Trachonitis, and Licinius, ruler of Abilene. During the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah, "The voice of the one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God." John said to the crowds that came out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruits worthy of repentance. Do not say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor,' for I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is laying at the root of the trees. Every tree that therefore does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire." And the crowds asked him, "What then shall we do?" In reply, he said to them, "Whoever has two coats must share with anyone who has none, and whoever has food must do likewise." Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked him, "Teacher, what should we do?" And he said to them, "Collect no more than the amount prescribed for you." And soldiers also asked him, "And we, what should we do?" And he said, "Do not extort money from anyone by threats or false accusation, and be satisfied with your wages." As the people were filled with expectation, and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them, saying, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I'm not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." So with many other exhortations, he proclaimed the good news to the people. But Herod, the ruler who had been rebuked by him because Herodias, his brother's wife, and because of all the things that Herod had done, added to them all by shutting John up in prison. Now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in a bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, the beloved. With you, I am well pleased." Here ends our gospel reading for this week.
Greetings. I bring you a message of love and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus the Christ. Amen. It's been a tough week for me to put a message together this week. My heart is heavy, my will is weak, the events of the week are taking toll on many people, but in Christ we move on, right? Personally, it's been a tough year. Ingrid lives with pain on a daily basis, and that affects not only her, but those around her who care for her and love her. My oldest son has disabilities that make it difficult for him to find work or to keep a job. My younger son is getting married in May, and while that's cause for great celebration, and it will be great celebration, the overall pall hanging over us of the pandemic makes things questionable and how we're going to pull it off in a real celebratory way. I struggle with anxiety and depression, part of the gift of my attention deficit that bestows upon me. And along with these things, I was notified on Friday of Ginny Johnson passing away, a truly wonderful woman. We received recently news that a friend of ours has stage 4 cancer, and also another friend who, though but has been married for years, is now seeking a divorce. I don't bring these up to invoke pity or ask for concern from people. I think, unfortunately, this is pretty much a matter of a way of life for many families these days. So it's been a rough year. And on top of all these things that have been going on, the things that have plagued our lives and made things difficult, this past week we have this news of thugs who broke into the Capitol building in Washington. It's hurt our country to its core. Feelings resurfaced that I haven't felt since 9/11. And the disbelief that our country might be under a domestic attack just has shaken our nation. My initial response was thinking of Obi-Wan Kenobi. He was in the Millennium Falcon, I believe, and he's teaching young Skywalker how to fight in the ways of the Force. And suddenly he stopped in his tracks. He has to go sit down. He's like he's dumbfounded. And he said, I felt a great disturbance in the Force, as if millions of voices suddenly cried out in terror and were suddenly silenced. That's what I thought of when I saw those people breaking into the Capitol building. Such was the disturbance, the shock of it all, not only as we watched from our homes, but it was felt around the world as other nations reeled in shock similar to our own. Just last week, we celebrated the birth of a new year. The year 2020 was finally behind us, a year many have referred to as in terms of as a dumpster fire. In 2020, an acknowledgement we had was that nothing was going to be normal, and that life changed not just for a few, not just for those around us, but in our state, in our nation, and again, in the world. Now, a vaccine has been developed that sheds a little light on this pandemic. A dawn is breaking. Checks are being sent out by the government to help those who have been disenfranchised, lost their jobs, or seen their businesses dry up. Life should be looking up. But then we witnessed those things happening in the Capitol building in Washington. Now, in the midst of all this, we hear this lesson for this week of Jesus being baptized by John in the River Jordan, and the proclamation of John that something new, truly new and radical was coming and was going to be fulfilled even. In the midst of all the chaos and the craziness of the past week, I hear this lesson for this week, and my perpetual question rises up within me, so what? So what? I don't ask that flippantly or with any amount of sarcasm, but truth and concern. As a matter of fact, when speaking with other clergy this week, I asked pointedly to them, you know, did Jesus's baptism really matter? Does it really make a difference? Well, let's break this down into two separate issues, shall we? First, let's ask what a difference Jesus' personal experience of being baptized had on the world. Does it matter that Jesus himself was baptized? And why was Jesus baptized? And then secondly, the other part of this is, does our baptism mean anything? Was our baptism important? You know, baptism is a covenant, although mostly one-sided covenant. It's the rite of baptism in which sponsors in our tradition speak on behalf of a young infant or child, promising to instruct and to nourish them in the ways of the church in accordance with the teachings of the church and make sure that they grow in a healthy and right way. God makes promises in those baptisms too. God promises that are much more involved than our promises, and actually are the reason for our need for baptism in the first place. God promises to love and to care for us despite the baptized child or infant having little or no awareness of God making these promises. He has no understanding of God's promises of care and devotion, but yet God promises that. The child will have a chance to respond through her confirmation process. That process has a true and lasting meaning. But first, they have to be set aside by God and chosen to be members of God's far-reaching family and the family of the church. Jesus was baptized with a similar effect. Anointed by John in the river, Jesus was crowned and acknowledged as the Son of God and imbued with the Holy Spirit. No promises that we know of were made on Jesus' part. No confirmation teaching was prescribed. No tests, no sponsors needed. But make no mistake about this. This blessing by God was special. This ceremony was one that propelled Jesus into his public ministry far and wide. This moment of baptism by God with the help of Jesus' cousin John was important for the world to take note of. There would be no kingly coronation or tribunal of any sorts marking the beginning of the Word of God in flesh. But it was a small gathering in an out-of-the-way place in which God sparked something uniquely new. So it was important. But what about that second part of the question? What about, is our baptism important? It was important for Jesus, we understand. That started his ministry. That let people know who he was. But what about us? I guess in our baptism, we let people know who we are too. That we are members of the family of God. Surely we don't see ourselves as the same calling or having the same calling as Jesus. I don't recall any doves descending or words coming from heaven in any of the baptisms that I was present at. But that doesn't mean that these weren't ordained by God in the same way that Jesus' baptism was. God may not have spoken directly in these baptisms like we have here on a Sunday morning in Vermont. But God did speak through someone who was chosen by God to speak on God's behalf. Just as John had continued this baptismal tradition, and the disciples later on, as they were taught by Jesus also to go and baptize. Through that tradition, we have been given responsibilities. As the bystanders were instructed, whoever has two coats must share with anyone who has none, and whoever has food, do likewise. Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked him, "Teacher, what should we do?" And he said to them, "Collect no more than the amount prescribed for you." Soldiers asked him, and we, what should we do? And he said, "Don't extort any money from anyone by threats or false accusation, and be satisfied with the wages that you yourselves receive." Whether you realize it or not, whether you spend time to feel the difference in what it means to be a baptized child of God and a member of a church, God, through this baptism, has made a difference in your life. God has adopted you. This church family has claimed you as their own. It's funny how many people I've had come up to me at funerals or weddings or other events during the year, and they'll say to me, "You know, Pastor, I haven't been to Vermont Lutheran in a long time, but I was baptized there." It makes a difference, doesn't it? "So, okay, Pastor, this is well and good, but you have two different sermons here, the state of our nation in chaos, the importance of baptism. What's the deal?" Well, the deal is that as baptized children of God, we are both of this world as well as citizens of the kingdom of God. We have a responsibility to this world and to the order that we choose to defend and uphold. We have a responsibility to God, who demands that we have higher hopes and expectations as God's children in God's kingdom. As baptized children of God, we have a responsibility to our neighbors to care for them and to assist them. As baptized children of God, we have a model in which we live, that from Christ Jesus, who decries violence and lawlessness. As baptized children of God, we have been taught by Jesus to care for one another and their property, and to respect rightful laws from the lawgivers. We have a responsibility to hold accountable in charity those who act forcefully and disgracefully against us, against our neighbors, and to teach them the errors of their ways, to lift them up kindly, gently, in love. For most of all, above everything else, we have been given the command to love each other. Even those that we might consider unlovable, or those who for us are beyond loving us in return. So even though we might hold these insurgents from this week in low regard, we still love them, and we understand that God loves them too. Even though we have been hurt and shocked and traumatized, we need to recognize that those who break our laws, like breaking into the Capitol, may also be baptized children of God, who are just as imperfect as we are. Though reprimand may well be necessary and deserved, let us understand that they too are loved by God and deserving of our care. They will not be excused, but they may be forgiven. For we are baptized children of God, and that is important. Let us pray. All-powerful God, You have called us your own, and for that we are eternally thankful. As human beings, we know that we are prone to failure and imperfect in your sight, and yet you still love us. Help our world to heal, Lord, in mind and in body. Give us patience and strength to meet the days ahead and to continue to strive to fulfill your will. In the name of our baptized Lord, Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Go. Love each other. Amen.
Remembering that our lives are an offering to the Lord and all we do is a continuation of his gifts to us, let us continue by praying our offertory prayer. Lord, you taught us that whoever has two coats can share with those who have none. Bless these gifts which we offer and multiply them, so that no one needs to go without basic necessities, and so that all may thrive in your love. Amen. Let us pray together the prayers for the church. We pray for the church, the world, and all those who are in need. Lord, you invite us to open our hearts to your message of transformation, but it is still up to us to do so. Give us courage to take the plunge into a life of service, with all its surprises and challenges. God of power, hear our prayer. Show us how to serve you in our jobs, responsibilities, and leisure, so that our daily lives reflect the restored relationship which we have with you. God of power, hear our prayer. With all your saints, we praise you in this life and the next, remembering the amazing things that you have done for us. God of power, hear our prayer. Receive our prayers and shed light on our path as we seek to walk in your ways and bring glory to you through your Son, Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Then let us continue by praying our prayer that our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and give you peace. Let us go in peace and serve our Lord. Thanks be to God. One simple reminder that the church's financial obligations do continue, even though we cannot meet in our church for worship. Please consider this and the ministries that are continuing in Vermont Lutheran Church and give with your heart as well as your wallet. Welcome again to join us next week as we worship in this place. And until then, may God grant you peace. Amen.